The government responded to the surge in the price of petrol with a three-month cut to fuel excise taxes and by making public transport half price. But transport currently makes up a huge share of New Zealand's carbon emissions. And when there is such political sensitivity to the price of petrol going up, what does that mean for New Zealand's climate change commitments? Rosie Collins is an economist at Sense Partners who specialises in the economics of climate change, and she joins us from Pōneke from Wellington this morning. Kia ora, Rosie. Did the government do the right thing?
Morning. They took a very immediate sort of response to an immediate problem, but cutting fuel taxes isn't a very targeted way to reduce the cost of living. So I think they did what they needed to do in terms of showing that they care and showing that they needed to act, but they didn't do it in the way that most economists would choose to.
What would have been a more targeted approach?
So we've got tools in our toolbox that we already use around tax credits, income tax, boosting benefits and things like that. So they could have looked to boost, say, the winter energy payment in the future, or sort of announce changes to benefits and things like that.
We know that the cost of petrol impacts parties politically, and that voters are incredibly sensitive mm-hmm. to the price of petrol. But as well as a cost of living crisis, New Zealand faces a climate crisis. The world faces a climate crisis. Was this a missed opportunity to change consumers' behaviour when it comes to using fossil fuels?
I think the role of price in transport decarbonisation is relatively limited. So we know that people don't actually respond that much when fuel prices are high. At least wealthier groups don't. They continue to drive. In those situations, we need to have other tools in the toolbox, sort of increasing public transport, increasing cycleways, removing parking to make parking a hassle, and things like that. So I don't think it's a missed opportunity for climate change. And in fact, the forecast oil prices that the Climate Change Commission are using are relatively flat and in fact lower than what they are now. So we wouldn't see these sorts of prices until 2030 on their modelling. So we're not in any ways behind on our decarbonisation objectives by cutting this fuel tax. But we do need to see other policies to actually get the systems changed that we need.
That's really interesting. So talk to us just a little bit more about that. Despite the sensitivity around the price of petrol, higher fuel costs don't necessarily mean people use much less of it.
So there's a split experience across groups. So low-income groups tend to treat transport like luxury goods. They're happy to cut down on it and travel less when prices go up, but wealthier groups don't tend to respond to the price, they just wear the cost, and so their behaviour is harder to change with the price lever. And for low income groups, when the prices go high, you do need to look at things to improve equity so that those groups can still get around when prices are increasing.
Why is
and even within that group there's a split of experience between there's a split in experience between those who don't consume much transport at all and those that have to drive for work. So it's really the ones that have to drive for work because they, say, live far out or their work is out of town or on the fringes in industrial areas, say, that will wear the cost of higher fuel costs sort of most acutely.
Why is there such sensitivity to the price of petrol?
I think it's one of the only goods that we all buy together in similar quantities. And it's quite a visible cost, so we can all talk about it and sort of understand what a price of a litre of petrol means and how much it roughly costs to fill up a car. With things like housing, even though they consume a lot more of our budget, transport might be less than 10% of a budget, whereas housing can be 30 to 40% for some groups of their spending in a week. But the cost of housing is really hidden, so we don't see the overcrowding, we don't see the people who have to move towns, people that have to live far out, or live in really crappy homes. Those become more like horror stories, whereas I think fuel prices are an objective price on a sign. And if we had a sign, say, for how many families lived on the or are waiting on the social housing register, perhaps that would be more visible as a cost. But really it's about fuel being a really visible and sort of grudge purchase that we just have to consume.
Will halving the cost of public transport make people more likely to use it?
So in general, when the price goes down, people will use it more, and it will help with people, again, in that low-income group that are really struggling who have good access to transport. There's been sort of cases in Estonia where they've made public transport free altogether, and public transport use increased about 15%. But the caveat there is that they already had quite good public transport systems, There are some systems, say I think in Wellington, that are pretty good, that if you made them cheaper, it would increase uptake a lot more. Say that I'm from Tauranga and the bus system there is just painful to use. And so even if you make it free, I think that uptake would be relatively limited. So there's a balance there between the price of something, but also the convenience and the ease of being able to use it. And again, for that sort of group who are happy driving, it's really about making driving a hassle and at the same time driving that wedge and price bigger so that you get the shift on both sides.
So you're saying fuel would have to be more expensive for consumers filling up their cars, but at the same time public transport would have to be really cheap to make it attractive. What would be the impact on our emissions? Have I got that wrong?
Well, I think not just fuel being more expensive, but actually parking being a hassle and it being annoying to drive into town and to do those trips that you might otherwise take a bus for. If you're, say, in a suburb and you can just hop on a bus into town, if it's going to take you half an hour to find a park, that's more of a painful nuisance of a cost than actually the cost of fuel being 20 cents more. So it's a lot of psychological factors at play with transport, not just the cost of fuel. And that's why price levers themselves alone won't be enough. It's got to be a range of factors.
What would be the impact on our emissions if all public transport was free?
I mean, it would depend again on how much the network was used. So I think the risk with making public transport free is that perhaps people don't value it and it could become a political barrier to actually extending the networks and frequency. So there's a real psychological question to get around with whether or not public transport should be free. Certainly if we discount it, uptake will increase for those lower income groups. The emissions effect, if we can decrease driving, is significant and is one of our main climate policy goals for New Zealand. So roughly 30% of our emissions that we actually bear, if you sort of exclude the agriculture that we export, is transport. So focusing on getting rid of car dependency is a really important aspect of that, and improving public transport is one lever that we need to do. But we also need cycleways and to improve walkability, to actually have affordable housing in the cities in the first place. It's something that's often missed, is that people have to actually be able to live close to an urban centre and afford to live there. So there's a range of other factors going on as well.
There was a carbon credit auction earlier this week where the price cap was hit once again and we used reserve credits. Can you explain what it actually means under the ETS when we hit the carbon price cap?
Sure. It's essentially a safety valve, and the idea is that we don't want prices to be too volatile too quickly. So there's a guardrail on both sides so the price doesn't get too low and the price doesn't get too high. The cap indicates that prices are on the up, which has been signalled by the Climate Change Commission is that they will, in the next 10 years, continue to rise. $70 cap is roughly half of what the EU ETS price is at the moment, so it's not anything to be afraid of that we're hitting the cap. It sort of puts us in the middle of the pack in terms of carbon pricing, and it really is sort of the first time we're seeing the ETS actually work as it should, because for so long the prices have been so low that you couldn't really see that behavioural effect that we're looking for in terms of incentives to reduce emissions. So